بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله أما بعد السلام عليكم brothers and sisters how you guys doing today we're going to talk about the birth of the prophet peace be upon him and the major events that would occur before he would become a prophet so this is part 3 and this is what we're going to discuss now the prophet peace be upon him was born on a Monday in the Islamic month of Rabi'ul Awwal in the year of the elephant And we discussed last week, why was it called the Year of the Elephant? Why was it called Am al-Fid? So, the mother of the Prophet, peace upon him, Amina, when she was to give birth to the Prophet, peace upon him, she would inform Abdul Muttalib immediately. And Abdul Muttalib, when he heard the news of his grandson, he was beyond happy and very, very excited. In fact, it was he, Abdul Muttalib, who would give the Prophet, peace upon him, his name. He would name him Muhammad. And Muhammad was not a name that was common to the Arab. So he gave him like a special name, you could say, right? So now, the Arab, what they used to do when they used to have babies is that they used to send them to the Arab Bedouins in order for them to learn the pure language, have good manners, to build strong bodies. And the Prophet, peace upon him, would also be sent to a Bedouin family. Now, who was the family that the Prophet, peace upon him, was sent to? He was sent to the Bedouin family of Halima. And Halima, as we're going to talk about her narration, she says that when the Prophet, peace upon him, was with her and her family, they experienced nothing but blessings and happiness and miracles and all of these sort of things. So now, Halima narrates to us that it was a year of drought and famine. We had nothing to eat. I rode on a donkey and we had a she camel. Now the she camel that they had was old and it didn't even produce milk. And even she says, as we're going to get to know, it didn't even produce a dot of milk. And the donkey that they were riding to go to Mecca in order for them to get, you know, a child for them to nurse and receive money, was very, very slow and very, very skinny and very, very weak. Now, Halima continues and says, we could not have a wink of sleep during the night, for the child kept crying from hunger. Since the she-camel could not produce any milk, she could not feed herself and receive the vitamins and nutrients in order for her to feed the child that was with them. So the child from the hunger would stay all night crying and they couldn't get no sleep. So we continue. She says, we used to keep making dua for immediate relief. When we finally reached Mecca, we started looking for a child to nurse. None of the women wanted the Prophet, peace be upon him, for he was a orphan. Every woman that was with her in journey to Mecca, including herself, they did not want the Prophet, peace be upon him. Why? Because he was an orphan. What does that have to do with anything? It's because they feared that since he doesn't have a father, then there might be some days or might be some months where they couldn't get paid. So they're like, you know what? I don't even want that headache. Let me just get a regular child where I can get my money and don't have to be worried about them not paying me. However, Halima says, when we were about to depart, every woman had a baby except for me. I said to my husband, by Allah, I do not want to go back with the other woman without a baby. I should go back and take the orphan. Then, so you see that Halima, she didn't want the Prophet, peace upon him. However, when she was to take the Prophet, peace upon him, and from this moment on, she would realize, and we would realize, that this is one of the greatest and best things that she ever decided on doing. She says, when I lifted him, the Prophet, peace upon him, I put him to my breast, and to my great surprise, I found enough milk in it. He drank to his heart's content, and so did his foster brother, and both of them went to sleep. SubhanAllah, we see the day before that there was no food for the baby, so he stayed up all night crying. However, when she decided to take the Prophet, peace upon him, not only did the Prophet, peace upon him, drink, however, he drank to his fill, and so did his foster brother. And they both went to sleep, and they were both not crying from hunger. Now we continue. She says, then my husband went to the she-camel to milk it, and amazingly, he found plenty of milk in it. He milked it, and we drank to our fill, and enjoyed a sleep that night. So not only did the Prophet, peace be upon him, benefit, but just by the Prophet, peace be upon him, being with them, SubhanAllah, like we said, they're going to experience many blessings and miracles. The she-camel had plenty of milk in it, and they drank till yani they couldn't drink anymore. As the camel that couldn't produce a drop of milk before the Prophet, peace be upon him, came and accompanied them. So now we continue. After 2 years, the Prophet, peace be upon him, was supposed to return to Mecca with his mother Amina. However, Halima, after experiencing all these miracles and blessings and good times with the Prophet, peace be upon him, she didn't want to let that go. So she started asking Halima, as she started asking Amina, please let him stay with me. And Amina agreed, and the Prophet peace be upon him returned with Halima. However, something would happen, and Halima would rush to give the Prophet peace be upon him back to Amina. What happened? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us in Surah Al-Sharh, in the first ayah, أَلَمْ نَشْرَحْ لَكَ صَدْرَكَ. What is this referring to? But about when the Prophet peace be upon him was about 4 or 5 years old, Angel Jibreel, he came to the Prophet peace be upon him and opened up his chest. أَلَمْ نَشْرَحْ لَكَ صَدْرَكَ. That the Prophet peace upon him's heart, chest was open. Angel Jibreel took out the Prophet's heart, cleaned it with Zamzam, took out the black spot that was in it, and returned his heart. However, the boys and the friends with the Prophet peace upon him, when they seen this, they immediately rushed to Halima. And Halima came running because the kid said, "Verily, Muhammad has been murdered." So when she heard this, she immediately rushed to the Prophet peace upon him. When they returned to the Prophet peace upon him, yes, he was alive. However, his face was white and he was lying on the floor. So after this, Halima was like, you know, she doesn't want this responsibility. She doesn't want this, you know, anything bad to happen to the Prophet when he's under her protection. So she returned him to Amina. Now, once she returned him to Amina, not too long after, when the Prophet peace be upon him was 6 years old, on a trip returning back from Yathrib, Medina, Amina passed away. And the reason why they were in Yathrib is because the Prophet peace be upon him, Amina, Abdul Muttalib, and Ayman, they went a trip to Medina, Yathrib, to visit the grave of Abdullah. And in that journey, on the way back, the Amina died. Now, when Amina died, the Prophet, peace upon him, was now without a mother and without a father. So now the guardianship or the protection of the Prophet, peace upon him, would now be in the hands of Abdul Muttalib, the grandfather of the Prophet, peace upon him. And now Abdul Muttalib, even though he loved the Prophet, peace upon him, and, you know, viewed him in a very, very grand and high way, this even increased after these incidents. And now he would treat the Prophet, peace upon him, as, you know, basically a full adult. And even Abu Talib, who we're going to discuss right now, even he treated him as like a full grown adult when he was still a young kid. And of course, Abdul Muttalib, he would always be supportive and pleased with the Prophet peace be upon him. And he used to swear to the people of Quraysh, he says, "By Allah, I swear that the Prophet peace be upon him would hold a significant position." And subhanAllah, wasn't he right? The Prophet peace be upon him, in fact, has the greatest position of all the creations of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now, at the age of 8 years old, Abdul Muttalib would die and Abu Talib would take guardianship or responsibility over the Prophet peace be upon him. And also Abu Talib, following the footsteps of his father Abdul Muttalib, because Abu Talib was the brother of the Prophet peace be upon him's father, would treat the Prophet peace be upon him in a great way, in a respectable way, and in a way that, you know, kids wouldn't be treated. As we're going to discuss right now, some of the incidents that the Prophet peace be upon him was a part of, and he shouldn't even be a part of them. You know, this was a gathering of adults and elderly and honorable men, yet the Prophet peace upon him at such a young age was a part of it and was interested in being a part of it. The first incident that we're going to talk about is Bahirah. And before we even talk about Bahirah, something I forgot to mention is that Abu Talib, he would not die during the initial stages of the life of the Prophet peace upon him. In fact, he would be living for the next 30-40 years, if my math is correct. And he would even witness the prophethood, and he would, of course, as we're going to discuss in later episodes, would reject or deny in accepting Islam. Now, going back to Bahirah, like I said before, when the Prophet peace be upon him was 12 years old, he went on a trip with Abu Talib to Syria. Again, in a place that, yani, 12 years old, going on a trade trip is not something that's usually happening. However, the Prophet peace be upon him accompanied Abu Talib. So when they went to Syria, a monk named Bahirah, he recognized the Prophet peace be upon him. And he said to Abu Talib, "This is the master of all humans," referring to the Prophet peace be upon him. "Allah will send him with a message which will be a mercy to all human beings." Subhanallah. What does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tell us in the Quran? "وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا رَحْمَةً لِلْعَالَمِينَ." We have not sent you except for as a mercy. Look what Bahirah says about the Prophet peace be upon him, that he will have a message and he will be a mercy to all beings. Abu Talib, of course, asked, like, "How do you know this?" So Bahirah said, "When you appeared from the direction of Aqaba, all the trees and stones prostrated themselves, which they never do except to a prophet. Also, the seal of prophethood, which is beneath his shoulder." So the Prophet peace be upon him had seal of the prophets that was underneath his shoulder. It was nothing crazy. It was just like a little, you could say, birthmark, or a little protrusion coming out of his skin that was the seal of the prophets. And Bahia says that we have found this and this information in our books, so we know that this is a prophet. And subhanAllah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us in Surah Al-Baqarah that وَلَمَّا جَاءَهُمْ رَسُولٌ مِّنْ عِنْدِ اللَّهِ مُصَدِّقٌ لِمَا مَعَهُمْ, that when it came to them a prophet which, from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which was confirmed with what they have, meaning the people during that time, they knew that the Prophet, peace upon him, was a prophet, and it was confirmed in their books. We have proof right here. Bahira saying that this is in our books, and we know this is true because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us in the Quran that they did have proof that the Prophet, peace upon him, was coming and that they had signs of prophethood. Of course, Abu Talib would obey and listen to him, because Bahira said that if the Jews and Romans would see him, they may harm him. And we also know this in Surah Al-Baqarah, that the people, they used to kill and harm their prophets. So if they see the Prophet, peace upon him, and recognize him as a prophet, they're going to harm him. So of course, Abu Talib would return him to Mecca. Now, the next major event that would happen is Hilf Ul-Fudol. What is Hilf Ul-Fudol, for those who don't know? It's in a confederacy, or an alliance, or an agreement that the people of Mecca made when they were tired and they were sick of all the violence and transgression and evil things that were happening. They wanted to stop all these people taking advantage of the poor and the weak. So they wanted to gather with all the tribes of Banu Hashim and all the other tribes of Mecca in order to agree on something that would stop this. And they would meet in Abdullah ibn Jad'an's house, and they would enter agreement which they were looking for. Now, why am I mentioning this? What importance does it make? Is because the Prophet, peace be upon him, during his prophethood, would comment about this event. The Prophet, peace be upon him, says, and I quote, "I witnessed a hilf," with hilf meaning agreement, alliance, confederacy. "I witnessed a hilf in the house of Abdullah ibn Jad'an. It was more appealing to me than the herds of cattle." Now, what does this mean? It's basically just an expression showing how much interest he had in it, how much it appealed to him. And subhanAllah, like we said, the Prophet, peace upon him, is not an elderly, honorable man at that time. He's a, you know, someone young, someone who people at that age were out, you know, having fun and everything. However, he was interested in things that only interested elderly, honorable men. Subhanallah. So even the Prophet, peace upon him, at a young age, was interested into the, you know, the things that really mattered. And he says, continuing the hadith, "Even now in the period of Islam, I would respond positively to attending such a meeting if I were invited." Subhanallah. So we get two things I want to mention from this last quote, is that I would respond to this event. That even in this time of Islam, if something were to happen, people of different religions or people of different tribes or anything wanted to agree on something to help the weak and poor, I would join. Also, something that I found popping out to me is that when he says, if I were invited, that if I were invited, that I'm not going to kill myself, I'm not going to jump over a building in order to be a part of them, is that if they invite me and what they're inviting me to is something reasonable and something that makes sense that we need to stop, then I'm going to join them on the basis of that agreement. So something that we can learn from, inshallah, maybe in a different video, not in the Seerah series, but in something else, we could talk about the importance and the wisdom of Hilf Ul-Fudol. Now, the Prophet, peace upon him, introduction to the next major event, is that the Prophet, peace upon him, would work as a shepherd for the Bani Sa'd, and he would receive compensation for that. And also, we learned that all the prophets, peace be upon them, were all shepherds. And you could say the wisdom behind being a shepherd, all of them being a shepherd, is them learning how to lead a flock, or lead the ummah, in terms of directing them from destination A to destination B. Our destination A, where we are, is dunya, and our ultimate destination is, of course, Jannah. So the Prophet, peace be upon him, we follow him in order to attain that. So you can say that's the wisdom of them being a shepherd. Now, at the age of 25, the Prophet, peace be upon him, would receive a job offer from Khadijah binti Khuwaylid. And Khadijah would offer him a job on the basis of, after her hearing of his honesty and his trustworthiness and his manners and all these great things about him, she would offer him a job with the amount of money she never paid anyone, and no one would offer the Prophet, peace upon him, that much money. In fact, she would even give him an assistant. She would send her servant Maysara with him as well. So the Prophet, peace upon him, was offered this job for Khadijah, and he was going to be the merchant for her in going to Syria. Now, Khadija offered the job, like we said, because of the Prophet, peace upon him's great manners and great wisdom and great, you know, faith and trustworthiness. However, when the Prophet, peace be upon him, returned back, Maysara just kept telling Khadija about the great things the Prophet, peace upon him, did, his iman, his belief, his faith, his honesty, his trustworthiness, all these kept saying good things about him. And the Prophet, peace upon him, upon returning from Syria, he gave Khadijah an amount that she never seen before. He made her the most money in that trip. And subhanAllah, this shows you that the Prophet, peace upon him, even at that age, yes, he was trustworthy. He was also, you know, someone who can do business, someone who took a responsibility and took it to the next level. As we talked about last week in terms of his ancestors, that when they were given a responsibility, when they were given a task, they did the best in it. So now, after hearing this, Khadija now became interested in the Prophet, peace be upon him. And this is something that wasn't natural to Khadija, because a lot of men used to ask for her hand in marriage, but she used to always refuse. But after seeing that the Prophet, peace be upon him, is such a great man and hearing so much about him, she became interested in him. So she told one of her friends to inform the Prophet, peace be upon him, of her interest. And the Prophet, peace be upon him, would also be interested in Khadija. So he would tell his uncles to go speak to the family of Khadija in order for them to discuss this matter. And this would lead to the Prophet, peace be upon him, marrying Khadija when she was the age of 40 and he was the age of 25. Now, when the Prophet, peace be upon him, was married to Khadija, all of his kids were from Khadija, except for one, which is Ibrahim, which we might discuss in a later episode. However, all of his kids, which he had three sons in total, all of the sons died at a young age. All of the daughters of the Prophet, peace be upon him, would also die in the lifetime of the Prophet, peace be upon him, except for one, which is Fatima, who would die shortly after the death of the Prophet, peace be upon him. Also, another fact about the daughters of the Prophet, peace be upon him, all of them would witness Islam, accept Islam, and make hijrah. So they were all from the Muslimin, alhamdulillah. Another major incident that happened, which a lot of people didn't know, including myself before I studied Seerah, was that the Kaaba was rebuilt before the Prophet was a prophet. So at the age of 35, the Prophet, peace be upon him, witnessed the rebuilding of the Kaaba. In fact, he played a key role in rebuilding it, as we're going to discuss right now. So 5 years before the Prophet, peace be upon him, would receive the Quran and become a prophet, the Quraysh, after seeing the Kaaba being almost destroyed by a great flood that hit Mecca, they decided that we need to rebuild the Kaaba and make it strong again because it was weak. So they gathered and decided that we have to rebuild the Kaaba and make it strong and, you know, great as it used to be. They also agreed, subhanAllah, something interesting is that the only money they're going to use to rebuild the Kaaba is lawful, clean money. That all the money they got from riba and cheating and stealing and all these immoral means, we're going to throw that in the trash and we're not going to use that to build the Kaaba. So they only used the good money to rebuild the Kaaba. So now, when they rebuild the Kaaba, of course, when you start rebuilding the Kaaba or rebuilding anything, you have to destroy the old walls, right? The old foundation, not the foundation, but the walls around it. So they were shot. They didn't want to destroy the wall. Why? Because 35 years from that day, what happened? Abraha tried to destroy the Kaaba. So they were all scared. Like, we don't want to destroy the Kaaba. We don't want to be destroyed like Abraha was destroyed. So they kept at this state until Walid ibn Mughir al-Makhzumi, he took the first act. He was like, you know what, khalas, I'm going to try see what happens. So when he started, you know, taking down the walls of the Kaaba, nothing happened to him. So then the Quraysh started joining in and taking down the walls and starting to rebuild. Now, all the tribes and all the clans, they had a responsibility and a duty in rebuilding the Kaaba. And everything was going good. Everyone was doing their job. No one, you know, no major fights were happening. And so one incident happened and that changed everything. And when this incident happened that we're going to discuss, almost tribal war and bloodshed and great, you know, fighting was about to occur. What was the problem? Is that who has the responsibility or who has the honor in putting Hajar al-Aswad back into the Kaaba? Every single person wanted to have that honor to put the Hajar al-Aswad back into the Kaaba. So this will cause great bloodshed. Like, everyone wants it. No, my tribe is going to do it, or my son is going to do it, or this person is going to do it, that person is going to do it. So no one wanted to do anything. And right before they were about to, you know, start fighting and major bloodshed was going to happen, Abu Umayyah ibn al-Mughir al-Makhzumi, he proposed a deal. And he said that the next person to enter the sanctuary or the haram, we're going to give him to choose who's going to put it in. So everyone's eagerly waiting who's going to be the next person to enter the haram. And subhanAllah, by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the next person to enter the haram, to enter the sanctuary, was none other than the Prophet, peace be upon him. And when he entered the sanctuary, brothers and sisters, everyone, they were happy and they were crying out in joy. Al-Amin has come, Al-Amin has come. Because everyone knew and loved the Prophet, peace be upon him. Which goes back to my original point last week, is that the Prophet, peace be upon him, wasn't unknown or came out of nowhere. In fact, he was loved and viewed highly by everyone. And this is a clear example of it right here, is that the Prophet, peace be upon him, when he entered, everyone loved him and everyone knew that, whatever he says is going to be haqq, is going to be the truth. So everyone was waiting for his decision. And subhanAllah, the Prophet, peace be upon him, look at the way he thought, like critical and outside of the box. He said, put a garment or a blanket on the floor, and some of you guys know the story, and put Hajar al-Aswad in the middle, and he called representatives and clans from each of the tribes to hold a part of the blanket and take it towards the Kaaba. Now, when they came towards the Kaaba, the Prophet, peace be upon him, himself grabbed the Hajar al-Aswad and put it in its proper place. SubhanAllah, he got everyone involved, and everyone felt respectable and honored in terms of having a part in putting the Hajar al-Aswad inside the Kaaba. Now we have another problem. We said that the Quraysh is only going to use lawful money in rebuilding Kaaba. However, they ran out of this lawful money and couldn't complete the full construction of the Kaaba. Brothers and sisters, for those who don't know, the Kaaba, its original foundations, the way that Ibrahim alayhi salam and Ismail alayhi salam built it, was in a rectangle shape. However, the Kaaba we have today and the Kaaba that they would build is now in a cube shape. Why? Like we just said, they ran out of lawful money. So instead of using unlawful money to continue the building, they said, no, let's close it on its original, on this, in the shape that it's in, and build like the hijr. That's what it's called, the U-shaped structure, in order to show that the original borders, or the original foundation of the Kaaba. And that's the same Kaaba we have today. And the Prophet, peace be upon him, even during his prophethood, he told Aisha, his wife, that we didn't mention yet, if I didn't fear the arrogance and the ignorance of your people, I would have rebuilt the Kaaba on its original foundation. However, the Prophet, peace upon him, didn't do so. Also gives us a significance or a wisdom that we shouldn't be destroying and rebuilding the Kaaba and making it fancy and everything like that. So subhanAllah, the Prophet, peace upon him, was given the opportunity to do so, but he didn't do so. So now we know how the Kaaba was rebuilt and how it was shaped different than it was shaped during the time of Ibrahim alayhi salam and Ismail alayhi salam. And that will conclude this week's episode on the major events that happened to the Prophet, peace upon him, before he was a prophet, and some information about his birth as well. And brothers and sisters, reminder is that next week we're talking about when the Prophet, peace be upon him, would receive Wahi. In other words, when he's going to become a prophet. So this is when the seerah technically starts. Everything we talked about before, including today, is prerequisites. You don't need this. We just talked about it in order for us to make connections on what's going to happen in later episodes. In fact, it's something that's, you know, has to be learned in order for you to understand and fully visualize all the concepts and understand all the wisdoms you can gain from it. You have to know these certain episodes. So if you missed any of the episodes in past weeks, make sure you watch them and make sure you understand them, because they're going to play huge, huge roles in terms of when we start talking about when the Prophet talks about starts giving da'wah, and when he starts going to Habasha and Yathrib and all these other places. We're going to talk about the significance of some of these events that we quoted today. So make sure you share and tell your friends and family about last week's and the week before episode. Watch it, understand it, so that when we start talking about the actual seerah, when the Prophet, peace be upon him, is actually a prophet, you can understand everything and have all the knowledge in your head. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. See you guys next week, which is going to be the new episode 4, when the Prophet receives revelation, when he receives wahi.